I'm Rob Hamer. I'm head of alternative assets at Ashburton, and thanks very much for joining us. And Laurie, particularly thank you to you for joining us, making some time for us after your week at Davos.
Pleasure.
I think that was your 18th week at Davos, so it'd be great.
I've been
to
going
start
for 18 years, but yeah. I don't go every year.
Yeah. Okay. So great. So if you could just give us a sense of some of the notable changes that have occurred in that time that you've been going there.
Well, over the 18 years, it's certainly become more commercial, but also more transparent. So a lot of the big corporations use it to market, and you get these requests for one-on-one meetings. I decline the lot. I mean, why must I meet with the head of Visa Card if I can listen to Theresa May? So I don't do a single one-on-one, and I do no networking. I only attend sessions to gain knowledge. And then on the fringe, these big corporations are running breakfasts and dinners alongside the main event. It's a bit like the Hawkers outside a rugby stadium. Okay. Then the good thing is it's much more transparent. But when I've initially started going, there's no way that you really would know what's going on in the different sessions. Not that it was a big secret, just wasn't geared to that. So now, as you all know, you can watch sessions on Facebook, YouTube, etc., on news channels and everything. So it's very, very transparent. Then it's actually gone from paper-based to digital. In the beginning, we used to get a program, paper-based, a thick thing like this, participants, a door stopper of a thing, and you had to queue to sign up for sessions. Now you do it all on your mobile device, everything. The participants are there, the program's there, you book online, everything. But the interesting thing is, I must add, because you were collecting so much paper in the beginning, they had a facility from DHL, you could ship 2 kilograms of paper back to your home country for free. Okay, but now, in spite of all the digitizing, all the old legacy systems still remain. You could still do the DHL thing, you could still get a paper program, you can still get... And it's sort of a thing that's we all face. We move on, but you drag along the legacy system, even and that happens even at WEF. And then the other thing that's changed is security. So it is orders of magnitude more strict. And maybe you can just put up the first slide there. This will sort of demonstrate it. That's my wife. And it doesn't really do justice. The distance from that raised platform to our balcony, I can throw a sweet to them. Okay, so I mean, we actually almost had to have our curtains shut all the time, and they too—they're armed with submachine guns, body armor, etc., and they're just outside the Congress Center. So it feels to me like half the Swiss Army and half the Swiss police are in Davos for that week. I go through a metal detector 5 times a day, because as you move around, you have to go through metal. Now I've got an artificial knee, so I spend my life. no cars are allowed anywhere near the Congress Center. That wasn't like that 18 years ago because of fear of a car bomb. And it's just noticeable. You wear your badge outside your thick coat all the time because if it's hidden behind a scarf or anything, they stop you. I mean, you get stopped 4 or 5 times, you realize my badge is not shown. The quality of participants has remained unchanged. I could listen to 4 or 5 heads of state in a question of 4 days. And you meet interesting people. So the one day this is about 5 years ago, I'm standing in the queue at security, and the lady sees I come from South Africa. She says, "Oh, I've never been to South Africa. I've only seen it from space." Really? Okay. First woman astronaut in the world was in front of me. Ah. No, not many places that can happen. Okay. I've discovered this elitist label. I've explained that at least a third of the delegates there are from broader society. Nothing is debated in enormous depth. It's sort of like very soundbite-ish. You know, the guy gets 5 minutes to present a view. And so what you really get out of it alerts you to future reading or think this can happen. It's not a lecture. They try and keep it quick and fast-moving. Questions have to be short, etc. Okay, so that's...
So look, on that future reading topic, I must admit, just actually watching the sessions on YouTube is fascinating.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was pretty clear that the topic of globalization has really loomed large over Davos, as did the shadow of Mr. Trump. And so after Brexit, the election of Donald Trump, the rise of populist parties in many countries, these are big issues. International media has been forecasting that it's the end of globalization. So what was the view in Davos, your view on that?
Okay, so predictably, I mean, the Davos people would not believe in it's the end of globalization. They voted on it and 90% said it's been net positive for society. And I happen to agree with them. But I mean, I thought it was a historic moment for me in 1 week to listen to the head of the Communist Party in China, the Prime Minister of Britain, which is the oldest democracy in the world, preaching free trade, free markets, and globalization. And then the bastion of free enterprise in the world, which is USA, in the inauguration speech, the new incumbent is preaching protectionism. I mean, this is ironic on a tremendous scale. I think when you talk about globalization, you must realize there are winners and losers. Now, if you look at winners, the middle class of the world has increased dramatically. The people uplifted from poverty into the middle class in China and especially in India, okay? And inequality between countries has decreased, okay? Not then within countries, it's often increased, okay? Ironically, the Trump supporters were voting against equality because the gap between a blue-collar worker in America and a blue-collar worker in China is narrowed. And the American guy's not too happy about this.
I don't think they're too happy on that.
Yeah, okay, all right. But there's an irony in that. The losers have often been the uneducated or poorly educated in developed countries, all right, for obvious reasons. So if you're pro or anti-globalization, is often which side of this winning-losing equation do you sit? I attended a session where there was a Microsoft's legal counsel, and he pointed out that America, I think since 1989, had created 35 million new jobs. But if you look at the spread of these jobs, the increase amongst of jobs for graduates, college graduates, had gone up 107%, middle-class jobs 47%, and just if you just had a high school or less qualification, there's been a decline in the jobs created. So it's all ties into this, the whole question of the knowledge and digital economy. Okay. And sometimes you get useful information just traveling in a shuttle bus. So I had a guy from Nike with me, and I asked him, he says, Mr. Trump phoned you guys, he had to bring back the jobs from China. So he said to me, understand, we got 200,000 people making Nike shoes in China. He says, we can't fill those jobs in America because a lot of them are very mundane. The guy laces shoes, you know, and it doesn't pay that well. He said, don't think we can fill that job in America. This is just a practical approach. Also, you've got world supply chains. A place like Boeing, I mean, if you know how many countries make parts to assemble a Boeing, I don't know if you know, in South Africa we make Boeing parts and Airbus parts. Now, if you think you're going to disrupt these supply chains by ordering Boeing to have some component where they've developed expertise to come back from whichever country, it's just not going to happen. So I put a question mark behind, you know, how Mr. Trump's going to get jobs back.
I guess we're all going to watch that with interest. If you talk about winners and losers, the one session that was fascinating for me was Jack Ma from Alibaba, where he was kind of saying the Americans have sort of squandered their globalization dividend on all sorts of things like, I think, $3 trillion on wars and things like that. So
I just want to add that. So it was a former director of the Director General of the World Trade Organization. This is a senior player in the world around trade and that type of thing. When somebody said, but Mr. Trump says he's bringing back all these jobs, he's just said words, 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 words. Okay, was dismissive of it.
So I think where these kind of words get to pretty quickly is monetary policy and interest rates. And there were a couple of sessions at Davos on that, which you attended. So that's interest rates kind of drive everything. So particularly as a banker, any insights you
get? Okay, so it's very clear that interest rates in America are normalizing in other words, from these low levels, but not yet in Japan and Europe, okay? And everybody points out that this has been the slowest normalization process in the history of the world, and they don't expect it to be a rapid normalization, which I think probably everybody in this room would. Everybody seemed to agree the dollar would stay strong, except one guy, I'll get to him just now. And but one participant, Mr. David Rubenstein of Carlisle, he pointed out that the a lot of emerging countries collectively owe $4.5 trillion in debt, okay? It's dollar-denominated debt. And a very strong dollar could increase the risk of a default there. So this is for fund managers to factor in some event risk over there. So there were very few sort of, I'd call it, Trump men. We did have that, I think I'm pronouncing the name, Scaramucci. Okay, he was there, okay. And he said they need monetary policies to uplift the middle class. I don't know. But he didn't say what they are. I don't think he actually knew. And then he did repeat again, which we all know, aggressive infrastructure programs, simpler tax code, etc. The chairman of UBS thought that the dollar had about another 10 to 15 months to run before a correction. Okay, but the most interesting part was Professor Kenneth Rogoff, economist, I think he's Harvard. He made a throwaway comment because it was in a session where they were talking about people investing in safe assets post the great financial crisis, of which U.S. Treasuries and U.S. He says, Mr. Trump, if he's done nothing else, he's reintroduced risk into the bond market.
Look, I think monetary policy is probably the central question facing us as investors, so I know our panel's going to chat about that later. So kind of getting onto the geopolitical risks, and maybe what's happening is sort of developed markets are getting as much political risk as emerging markets these days, but certainly two of the geopolitical risks facing the world today are firstly the threat of that very fragile EU at the moment, and secondly the Syrian crisis, which maybe has contributed to that fragile EU. Both of them being major cause of the movement of people, and that in turn is fanning the nationalism and populism that we've heard so much about. You attended a few sessions on those topics?
Right, so the post-EU one, it's sort of the title almost says it's the EU's disintegrated, but it was the panel I attended was the Deputy Prime Minister of Belgium and the Foreign Affairs Minister of Slovak Republic, and then a very well-known Princeton historian stroke economist. So the four points were made pro the EU, and I think they're all valid. They say the EU is a very... the youth are very pro-EU. They said, why are you even debating this? Which I think is correct. EU is very important for combating terrorism, you know, this working collectively. And the one what I thought quite interesting among us is if it disappears or disintegrates the EU, you just have to recreate it, you know, because it's actually needed. And then the image of the EU is better outside the EU than inside, okay? But then the professor from Princeton, he says, no, not so fast about you can't debate this. And then he pointed out a fault line, which I was unfamiliar with, but which some of you may have picked up. He pointed out that in terms of the treaties that EU members sign, they commit to observing democracy and rule of law, okay? And he says there are already two states now that are rogue states in that regard, and he identified Poland and Hungary. Okay, so now his view was, if you don't act against them with regard to democracy and rule of law, the EU becomes meaningless. You know, it doesn't disappear, but people say, but you're not enforcing the rules. Okay, so I just found that quite interesting. Then I asked a question. So I said to them, okay, what is the end vision for the EU? Because I've heard senior EU people saying the end vision is a United States of Europe, a federal system like the United States of America, but with no nation states. So, which I personally think can never work, okay? The answer was quite surprising. He says, no, this is one of the ministers. We've debated this. The reality is currently, he says, the members want do not want more Europe, they just want better Europe, so they're not there. He says, but it depends upon how we handle the present crisis, whether we ever move to that. So what it says, it's not off the table, you know. That surprised me. I just thought that's a dream, you know, this thing. Mm. I just can't see it working, because Theresa May must have said 3 times in her speech, we want to be in command of our own destiny. You know, that was part of the exiting of the EU. And I think that same desire exists in a lot of the EU states.
So just on the EU, they asked Henry Kissinger in that final interview what he would advise Trump on a whole variety of things, one of them being the EU. And Kissinger, a very strong supporter of the Atlantic Partnership that he referred to, which the EU is obviously critical to, although maybe the way it's implemented could improve. So hopefully people are listening to that.
So my conclusion would be that EU has got more fault lines than we even know about. It doesn't mean it's going to disintegrate, but there are a lot of pressure points there. Then I sort of went on the Syrian one, because I think we're all touched by these pictures of these Syrian refugees, and the ultimate solution just must be that the people must return to Syria. Okay, so I'm not, and we all know that Syrian situation is very confusing. So what they've done now, and it's current right now, they've negotiated a temporary ceasefire. They're meeting in Astana, which is the capital of Kazakhstan, and the people that are meeting are Turkey, Iran, Russia, and the Assad, and the rebels. Okay. And the first problem that they had was Turkey said, we're not taking part in any of these negotiations if Assad is part of it. Then they got feedback from Iran and Russia, no Assad, no negotiations, no ceasefire. Okay, so now that's realpolitik. So now step two is to try and negotiate a permanent ceasefire. And then step three, if you can get that, is to find some sort of political solution. Okay. Now, stop at this point, and one of you in the audience says to the panel, do you think that the Syrians' population will return from wherever they are in the world if it's a solution that involves Assad? And do you think private capital will take part in the reconstruction process if Assad is involved? The question was never answered, and by implication, I don't think they wanted to say, no, we think it. So it's a very tricky situation. What was also discussed is how long it will take to reconstruct Syria. They estimate 20 years. 20 years, and then it's not to improve it, to bring it back to where it was. And at a cost of $200 billion, call it just short of 3 trillion rand. I mean, and the benchmark they've used was Lebanon. The civil war lasted 16 years there. So far, the Syrian war has been 6 years, but this destruction has been much greater in Syria. It just shows you what a civil war, how long, and how it can set back a country 20, 25, 30 years. Okay.
Obviously, very interesting omission that the Americans aren't at that table.
Yes. They were invited. They declined.
Really?
Yeah, they were invited. Okay. No, they were invited. I'm not certain why. But I mean, a lot of that you're not going to pick up. That's maybe what happens behind closed doors at a divorce.
So Davos, obviously underpinning all of this stuff, this whole discussion on inequality. Mm. And I think there's some really interesting new learnings coming out of Davos on inequality. How prominently did it actually feature there, and what sort of insights have you got for us there, Laurie?
So obviously it does feature because it's seen as a global risk, because it leads to populism and social unrest, inequality. And Christine Lagarde says you can't have rapid economic growth and inequality. They sort of work against each other. What is clear, no one has a silver bullet, okay? Mm. So it's a multitude of things. And I think we must differentiate South Africa between countries, inequality and income divergence, where, like America, disparity in income, versus South Africa, where we've got absolute poverty, which is part of inequality. You can't deal with them in the same way, in my view. Then we had Oxfam there. So now you're going to get my personal view around these issues. So Oxfam use very sensational tactics every year. They say this year it was the 8 richest people in the world own just as much as the 3.5 billion poorest people. And they sort of almost vilify those 8 people, okay? Now, I don't know, I actually done the calculation. So if you took everything that those 8 richest people owned, you confiscated it, every last dollar, right? And you distributed it to the 3.5 billion poorest people. You know how much each one gets? $500. Once off, and I'm not certain what you've achieved. Mm. Okay? So this, that's the first one. Then, possibly in those 8 richest people are the Google founders. Now, who of you use Google? I know, everybody. It's an incredible tool given to mankind, you will agree. This access to knowledge. How much do you pay for it? Nothing. Nothing. So I want to say, why they cross with Google? Well, the Google founders, all right. And then, unfortunately, Bill Gates, he's one of the 8, definitely. This now Oxfam sort of throwing barbs at that. Now, Bill Gates has donated 32 billion euro to his foundation. Oxfam, I think, donates 700 million euro per annum. So Bill Gates' donation is already equal to 45 years of Oxfam, all right? Bill Gates' foundation has single-handedly eradicated polio in Africa. And so I'm not a billionaire defender, but I think some context is needed. So, okay, now what can you do? You want to hear my views on the highest paid versus lowest paid?
Absolutely.
Okay. So I think it's a complete misnomer, this ratio. Now, and I'll give you, I'm going to use professional sport as an example. So Manchester United, a groundsman, you know, he mows the lawns, paints the lines, etc. He will earn about £25,000, okay, per annum. So let's double it, give him 50. So no one can argue he's getting a fair wage. Wayne Rooney gets paid £13 million, okay? So even at £13 million, the ratio is incredibly high. Would you agree?
Yeah.
But now, we're sitting there. Do you think we can halve Rooney's pay to get the ratio right? We must be honest.
Some people like to try.
No. No, you can try and halve it, and you know what? Next week he's playing for Barcelona.
Yeah.
Okay. So one of the things I got a few years ago, insights at Davos, was an eye-opener for me, was it's actually in the world it's become talent. It used to be capital versus labour. I think it's now talent versus the rest. Because that the owner of Manchester United is capital. He also has to contend with Wayne Rooney's pay. And it's this thing, or that talent gets extremely well rewarded. So the issue is, in my view of these things, you must be fairly paid for the job that you do. And you measure them differently in a company, the CEO versus, call it a lower paid worker. That's the issue.
So the talent getting rewarded, then you get to the access to the top end education that gets you to the top end.
Okay, no, okay. I'm all in favour of as much free education as you possibly can afford. Okay. Then the other things that I think we all agree on, this lobbying by the rich to change the rules in their favour, I think is wrong. There's good lobbying, bad lobbying. So if the corporations lobby the government to improve the efficiency of the border post between us and Zimbabwe, so that the trucks don't stand idle, that's good lobbying. Okay. However, if a pharmaceutical company has already got a 20-year patent on a medicine, right, tries to extend it to 40 years simply because it's good for their bottom line, I think it's bad lobbying. Okay, so I'm not in favour of the rich being able to, through lobbying and donations to political parties, bend the rules in their own favour. Obviously, the other thing is crony capitalism is a form of or a way of creating inequality. And one of the panels actually highlighted Carlos Slim as the Mexican billionaire as having got licenses for cell phones and sort of because he was an insider, that type of thing. Okay, so I'm... Okay. Then the other thing is, I think is this question of paying fair tax. Okay, so I look at free enterprise as a system. It does favour if you're well-educated, if you're an entrepreneur, a risk-taker, and you've got skills to sell. And okay, so if you see it as a franchise, you must pay a franchise fee, and that fee is tax. So I think what I am against is that Apple pays, they're not paying their fair share of tax. It's legal, but they're not paying. They have to, it's a philosophical...
It's legal, but is it right?
Yeah, it is legal, but is it right? I mean, because you're not, you've got a franchise that favours you, but you're not paying the franchise fee. Okay. And then, but also by the same token, if you've paid the franchise fee, the tax, I think you're entitled to get people to they must demand that they spend it properly. They don't waste your taxpayers' money. Now, one of the newer thoughts that's come up is a guy called Professor Guy Standing, and he's the professor of development at London University, and the founder of a thing called basic income, Earth Studies Basic Income. You can see this is a sort of a quite a leftish organization, but he's come up with an interesting idea, which is a universal, unconditional income grant. Everybody in the country gets this grant, from rich to poor, everybody, okay? And it's unconditional. You don't have to do anything to get it. Now, he's been working on this for 30 years, okay? And everybody's ignored him. And then suddenly, he's become mainstream, right? He's being invited to Davos and this type of thing. And a few countries are experimenting with this. I think it's Finland and Ontario in Canada and some cities in Scotland. So, and the reason why this thing has become mainstream is actually because people are thinking of this fourth industrial revolution and the whole question of technology removing jobs. So maybe we can just show you a clip.
But in the last couple of years, there's suddenly been a huge surge of interest, partly by a realization about automation. Now, I want to stress that that is not my rationale for a basic income. It never has been. But it's quite useful because it's made us much more topical. The reason I found that I always fought for a basic income are threefold. First, it's a means of social justice. This goes back to Thomas Paine and Henry George and people who said public wealth is created over generations. And any of us know, or should know, and have the humility to know, that our income and wealth is fundamentally due to the contributions of previous generations and much more than anything you or I do ourselves. And therefore, if you allow private inheritance, we should also have public inheritance as a social dividend on public wealth created. That means of social justice is fundamental behind why I believe in a basic income. The second reason is that it is a means to enhance republican freedom. Republican freedom is different from standard liberal forms of freedom in the sense that it means freedom from domination by figures of authority using their arbitrary power. It is a mechanism for enhancing republican freedom. And the third reason is that it is a means of providing people with basic security. Basic security. And in that regard, we claim, those of us who support basic income, it is not for eradicating poverty per se. It is for handling the issue of insecurity.
Right. So I'm just showing you there's some alternative thinking. That
I mean, I would say if all of us, if we watch nothing else from Davos, we should watch what that guy's got to say. He's got this concept, it's called the precariat. And it's kind of a blend between the words precarious and proletariat.
Precarious and proletariat. Proletariat. Yeah. So that's precariat.
And if there's any country in the world that's got an issue around that, you know, that's got to be
okay.
Us. So
now, how does he want to pay for it? And he covers it. He wants to look at what he calls a rentier income. So that's income that derives from ownership of property and investments, okay, which includes intellectual property. So if you've got a patent, a trademark, you get a royalty. He really wants to tax that heavily because collecting dividends, interest, rentals and all that, that's not work. Okay? This is not good for fund managers. Okay, but whether it is, I think the first point was, it was came up in another session, is the very poorest countries actually can't, if the per capita income is $700 in a poor country, I mean, what they can dish out is next to nothing. But I raise it here simply because it is something that is sort of getting a little bit of traction. It might die, but it...
And it also makes one thing, well, perhaps our social grants are...
Yes.
Actually some kind of step in that direction, and, you know, a very good thing, actually.
Yeah, our social grants are that, it's just narrowed down. It's not universal. Yeah. It's limited to a certain part. There were quite a lot of debate around what does this type of thing do to work ethic in a place. So I didn't go there, okay?
So, look, we can talk a long time on inequality, but what's also interesting is how the this whole concept of the fourth industrial revolution seems to be, people fear it's going to contribute to more inequality. And, Laurie, I see you wearing your Apple Watch, so you're kind of right there with the fourth industrial revolution. This year, there seemed to be a really much greater focus on artificial intelligence, which is a big part of that. And certainly, I think some of our panel members are going to talk about this. But what did you learn from the whole artificial intelligence?
The first thing is those artificial intelligence sessions were all booked out and filled to the rafters. They were very difficult even to get in. They were booked out very quickly. So people clearly think it's an issue. Now, I get a sense that many participants at Davos that said the world has not fully grasped the impact of this fourth industrial revolution and AI. Now, I want you, it was yesterday afternoon, Alan Pullinger, our deputy CEO, walks into my office. He says, have you seen this clip, Amazon Go? It's 1.5 minutes. You can find it on YouTube. It shows you the shop of the future with no tellers. It's beautifully done. But I promise you, you see that thing and you suddenly think tellers, cashiers at supermarkets could be an extinct species. But I urge you to go and watch it. It's actually very, very well done. Can the world handle this? Because remember what happens. Uber, there was social unrest around Uber. Okay? Mm. If you suddenly have these dramatic changes and disruption, it leads to social disruption too. Okay, so around... There's a lot of regulation and ethical issues around AI and call it the fourth industrial revolution. But one session I heard of that sort of made it clearer to me is where AI fits in was the head of IBM, Gina Rometty, and then Nadella, the head of Microsoft. They both saw AI as two components, augmentation or replacement. So they're more going the augmentation. So you get AI users to help all of us rather than replace us, okay? And I think there are those two streams, okay? Then I also attended a session on driverless cars. Why? This is a big issue for our insurance, okay? Now, it really is, because driverless cars are much safer, insurance premiums go down, okay? And it also highlights some of the issues around AI, okay?
Whose fault is it? Huh? There's a crash.
Yeah, yeah, but yeah. And who are we insuring?
Yeah.
Are we insuring the computer or who? There's a lot of issues there. So, but I mean, one of the things is they did point out we're not going to see gradual progression from driver assistance. You know, these things like lane change, all those stuff that we got, because that's used for a few minutes or a few seconds. Once a car starts driving, drives for hours. So you've got to get it right the first time. You can't say, oops, we'll fix it in model 2.4, you know? Yeah. Okay, exactly. So that was exactly the first observation.
Got to get that right.
They feel that it's unlikely to be targeted to the consumer in the beginning because, you know, you want a car that you can drive in all weather conditions, virtually all terrains, okay? So it's likely to be in more controlled environments. So think of us, you've got a driverless car running from Gautrain, yeah, through Sandton, same route, and it's a very controlled environment, and that'll work well. Or an open-cost mine, trucks going out. Okay. The other thing I didn't know, these driverless cars are not going to be controlled by huge programs, okay? So sort of that tells us what to do in every case. So, I mean, the example they use is It hasn't been programmed to say, uh-oh, here's a rolling ball coming over the road. Watch out for children. These programs, they learn as they go along. Okay. And then
they learn as somebody else at the
then car. The issue came up of the ethical side. Okay, it's a little bit theoretical, but it's interesting. So, one guy says, "Do you know that some of these driverless cars are being programmed that in a situation where an accident's unavoidable, that to do the assessment, you kill the least number of people. That's the which includes the driver in the equation." Okay, so he sketched this picture of the driver your car going up a steep mountainous pass, comes around a blind corner, and you have three hikers walking across and a cliff that side. Well, computer has been taught, 3-1. He goes over the cliff with the driver. And then he said, who's going to buy that car? Anyway, I think that side is more theoretical. And also, be careful about when you read all these public demonstrations of driverless cars. It's all being done in a very controlled environment, Paris, Tokyo, and so. Mm. And then I asked them, in our case, you know, we often have traffic lights down. People don't stop at traffic lights at late at night, and minibuses drive on the pavement. He says, no, that will take a bit of time for the car to learn how to deal with.
Yeah, exactly.
Do that. So I just want to add. So we're not going to be leading edge here in this country.
No.
on driverless cars. Okay.
So just one thing on the artificial intelligence. Brilliant presentation from Ginny Rometty. Mm-hmm. So the IBM, she's the CEO of IBM. The IBM Watson is their artificial intelligence system. Throughout her interview, she referred to Watson, the computer, as him. That's how they're thinking about it at IBM. So it's not
politically incorrect.
It's not it.
Okay.
It's not it.
Oh, I see.
It's not it. It's him. So that's
but
how.
Why not she?
Well, okay. It could have been she. Maybe Watson will
too
be
rational.
She. So, which maybe kind of gets onto the sort of other end of the coin on all this stuff is the privacy.
Yeah.
Other side of the coin.
So I attended a session on privacy around this whole digital age, and the first question we had to answer was, in 2025, that's about 9 or 10 years ago, will there be a big between privacy rich and privacy poor? In other words, rich people will be able to afford more privacy than poor people. And the voting went 80-20, 80, yes. And not exactly explained why people think that, but I could imagine one idea in that forum was that you have an app on your phone or your tablet which monitors the other apps and what data they're collecting. And I thought that's a very good idea. If you've got an app on your phone and it's telling you that app's collecting this about you, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and maybe that app's quite expensive and that's where it comes from. Then I think the other thing we must differentiate between is anonymous data. In other words, it's not you personally. So Google measures traffic congestion by the speed at which phones go past certain points. That's harmless and nobody has a problem with that. But then personal data is obviously the issue. Now, I learned something last night, believe it or not. Who of you knows in the computer age what a cookie is? And do you know what it does? So often you consent to them planting cookies.
Mm.
It tracks us. Yeah, well, it looks at what your browser. Okay, so I know actually an overseas insurance company. When it releases the cookies on your device, if it sees you have Googled something like how to improve my credit score, it's a negative. You're trying to beat the system.
And it's already thinking about you.
Yeah.
That intelligence.
No. So these are somewhere around, but I didn't know that's what a cookie does. And the problem is you either opt out of life or you sign up. No, but I mean, you can't go on, you know, often, okay? So I think one guy made the point, I think we're trading privacy for convenience.
Yeah.
That's what's happening, okay? And I'd like to just show you a clip here. We'll just hold it for a moment. It's from Kenneth Roth. He's the executive director of Human Rights Watch. And he talks about a consent culture or a consent framework or a legal framework. Right.
Implicit in the question, as I read it, it suggests that privacy is somehow a commodity, and that if you're wealthy enough, you can buy the commodity. We shouldn't think of it that way. We should think of privacy as a right. And it doesn't matter how much money you have, everybody deserves this right to privacy. The problem is that the right to privacy is incredibly poorly protected today. You know, Snowden showed that to us, but it's actually gotten worse, not better, than after Snowden. I mean, there were some modest reforms. We've seen Europe make, you know, some efforts with respect to data protection. But at the same time, there's been huge efforts with respect to counterterrorism that have justified the mass sweeping up of data. We've seen private companies move toward encryption, partly by popular demand, but encryption only deals with the content of communications. It doesn't deal with the metadata. You can't encrypt the metadata because the metadata has to tell you where the communication goes. And that metadata can be very revealing. This is a tracking device. And governments, companies, the police are able to follow me around. And that can be, you know, very incriminating. Who you call, who you email, tells a whole lot about your life. So I think we have, you know, an enormous need to have legal protections of privacy that are not there right now. You know, so far the answer to this has been, oh, but you consented to this. You know, when you subscribe to your internet service, you consented. You remember you read that form very carefully and then you signed at the bottom. But of course, you know, there's no real choice here. There are a handful of companies in any given field. They all have the same, you know, gobbledygook with a consent form. And unless you're going to opt out of private life, which isn't an option, there's no consent here. That's why we do need a regulatory regime, you know, not a consent regime.
Go for a regulatory regime or a consent regime. We've got consent at the moment. I don't know if it's actually possible to get to a proper regulatory framework given the speed with which this moves. And I personally think that it will end up just trusting certain companies. And by word of mouth, you'll gravitate towards companies who haven't abused your privacy. Because none of us, if any of you ever read the privacy policy, which you accept and agree to. None of us, okay, do you agree? And even though when we download a latest version of Apple, we don't read that.
It all comes back to trust and morals and ethics.
Absolutely. Yeah. So my conclusion is clean living. that's what we need. Right.
So Laurie, this Davos creates this really interesting intellectual space around all these fascinating issues that we've just discussed. How do you bring it back to SA, our participation at Davos, the 60 people from South Africa that, you know, who you were with? What are your takeaways? Stephen was very optimistic.
Okay. I sort of don't want to go there. I just want to say the benefit that I see. Obviously, for executives, you get exposed to this first-hand global thinking, all right, and the best brains in the world. And it's not like you get answers, but you get a sense of where things are going. And I'm very pleased that so many of our politicians go there, because suddenly you've got to sell the country. I didn't hear one word, white monopoly capital, radical economic transformation, right, used by any of our people, because they've got to moderate their language. It was you trying to sell this country to investors. It was also quite incisive when Cyril Ramaphosa referred to South Africa's institutional strength. He actually mentioned the institutions. Now, what's interesting is you'll tick them all. Our judiciary, tick. Our central bank, tick. Our public protector, yes. Okay. Definitely in the past. And then a good constitution. He didn't mention the MPA or SARS, okay? Because, no, he goes a guy, he can't.
Because he can't.
Because there's some investors in there, you know? I don't think they're uninformed. So you throw in something that people know is not correct. So in a nutshell, I think for our, especially our political leaders, going to Davos, it means you can see the world has moved on and it's not stuck in a time warp with sort of dogmas that are yesterday's story. So I think it's a very good effort. Then, okay, I'll just end here with the last thing. I call it snippets. Okay, this is stuff. Okay. This is what you pick up in the passages and this thing. So, here's one. I ran into the guy that organized the whole FIFA investigation, you know, with exited Blatter. So he says, I asked him, he says, nothing has changed. He says, that culture still prevails. They haven't been, he says, just give it 2 or 3 years and all the bad practices will be back there. Then I went to a session on corruption. Professor Joseph Stiglitz was there. He told an amusing story. So Panama called in him and this gentleman who told me about FIFA to make recommendations about how Panama can improve their image, you know, after the Panama Papers. So and it's all about transparency. Then Professor Stiglitz said to them, okay, we're going to be writing a report about transparency, so the report must be transparent. You can't have a report about transparency, report, yeah. And the report is not transparent. Then Panama said, no, that's a bridge too far, yeah, no. So I did that. And then I attended a session where we had to vote on whether Trump would complete his 4-year initial term. Now, obviously, if you'd had the same vote on Obama, even at the beginning of his term, you would have had 100% yes, he will. Trump, only 60% thought he's going to complete his... I'm in the 40%, who says he's not going to complete.
I must admit, I hope you're right.
Okay, so that's I've sort of covered a wide range of topics, but it's the very nature of Davos. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you very much, Laurie. Thanks for your time.